Well, welcome to the Helping Families Be Happy podcast, where we explore the often messy world of family, love, and relationships. I'm your host for this podcast, Christopher Robbins, the co-founder of Familius Publishing, husband, father of nine, author, fly fisherman, backpacker, and aspirational musician based in the Central Valley of beautiful California. We hope to bring you nourishing, real-life information about love, family, relationships, and life. And I'm stoked today to introduce our guest, Shaun Tomson. Now, Shaun Tomson is a former world surfing champion and has been described as one of the greatest and most influential surfers of all time. He is an inductee in the U.S., Jewish, and South African Sports Halls of Fame. Shaun is also a world-renowned leadership mentor, entrepreneur, environmentalist, and best-selling author. Today, we're talking about Anxious and Calm from his most recent book, The Surfer and the Sage, How to Survive and Ride Life's Waves. Shaun has been generous to agree to a series of podcasts throughout 2023, and we invite you to get stoked and learn how to survive and ride life's waves. The information shares align with Familius's 10 Habits of Happy Families. You can learn more about the habits of our happy families by going to the Habit Hub blog on familius.com. Now, welcome, Shaun. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks, Christopher. I see we both sporting beards now. This is a new thing for me.
Well, you know, just as a side, I was looking at photos from the 2022 National Beard Championships, and I think that you and I may have a long way to go to enter that.
Oh, yeah, definitely. We sporty and trim.
Yes, yes. Anyway, thanks for joining us. And your book is so helpful. You've already received letters from people who have, where you can tell that what you're writing or the information provided is helping their life. If maybe just share for a second that one that you shared with me a moment ago. Is that possible?
Yes. Yeah. So I got a letter yesterday from a business associate, and his name's also Shaun. So Shaun started reading The Surf and the Sage. He was halfway through it when one of his female friends was going through some personal struggles, and Shaun suggested the book. She read the book in 2 days and called him back and thanked him for the book and said that it had changed her life and thinking. She was extremely thankful and grateful. So those are the letters that, you know, authors really love to get. And when I wrote the book with Noah Ben Shear, we started writing it through COVID, and I was doing these virtual presentations with hundreds of thousands of people, and the words that people were sending me, I'd ask them, send me a word that describes how you're feeling, and I'd create a word cloud in my presentation. And the four words were stress, anxiety, depression, and disconnection. So those were the four words that were really top of mind for the American and the world population. So the very first chapter of the book describes anxious and calm, and every single chapter in the book is about the duality and how one can move from anxious and anxiety to calmness. And what we do is we don't give a prescription, no, no, but we just give a perspective on what you can do and little techniques perhaps that you can do, and then Noah gives sort of a spiritual exploration of both aspects. And that's all we want to do with the book. We want to give you a perspective. That's it. We don't want to give you a prescription, and we want to outline the duality, that life is about duality. Life is not all rainbows and unicorns and happiness and optimism, but there is sadness and suffering and resilience, and there is a way to overcome this malaise. You don't just sit there and be enveloped in the darkness and the mist of despair. You've got to rise up, and there is a way to combat this malaise.
So I believe that. I believe that I found in my life there's opposition in all things. Let's take a moment and just talk about that duality in that first chapter. You talk about the anxiety that can come from doing the sport that you love and that has made you famous in some ways, and how you've had to approach that and bring a calmness for you to be able to perform, to maximize your performance. Help us understand, what can we do when we're anxious to still have that strength of purpose, yet remain calm inside?
Yeah, I think anxiety is, it's a fear of the future. It's a fear of some future occurrence. It's a fear of failure, a fear of death. But anxiety, it is a state of mind. It's not like you have this immediate danger coming at you, which is sort of the fear response. It's like a fear of the fear in some ways. And how can you change that mindset? How can you alter the feeling of dread? So for me, and I talk in the chapter about riding the Banzai pipeline, the most dangerous wave in the world, the wave that's killed 18 people, and certainly it's a wave that always had a sort of a sense of dread for me. I mean, I even had a picture of the Banzai pipeline above my bed because I knew that was, I had to not conquer, but I had to surf the Banzai pipeline at a high level in order to fulfill my ambition of being one of the greatest surfers in the world. And so there was anxiety associated with, wow, one day I'm going to have to paddle out there. And I remember paddling out there and you do feel that anxiety because you've got to paddle into this wave, drop over the edge, and there's deadly coral below you, and you can have a very, very bad wipeout. And I found that a good way to change your mindset, to get rid of the anxiety, is just to breathe. Breath has got incredible power, and it's not meditation, because out there you're in a state of very heightened awareness, but breathing, you know what it's like? It's like a calming wind. And this notion of rhythmical breathing is calming. It calms the soul, it calms the heart, it calms the mind. So it's kind of like a connectivity to mind, body, and soul, this just rhythmical breathing. And it's really a simple thing to do when you're anxious about, what can you be anxious about? You can be anxious about a job interview. You can be anxious about a health issue. You can be anxious about a relationship issue. But just that breathing is so invigorating, so restful. And it just connects us to that pulse of our lives. One pulse every 60 seconds. So that's what I did. And that's what I still do.
That's wonderful. I've read more about breathing. We have one of our authors, Dr. Ben Bernstein, speaks a lot about anxiety. And he says that one of the first things we do when we are faced with stress or anxiety is we all of a sudden go, and he said, all of a sudden you stop breathing. And when you stop breathing, you're communicating to your body that you're dying. And that induces even more stress.
Yeah, it's like a spinning cycle of stress upon stress upon stress. It's you know, this downward cycle of like you say, a downward cycle where you're not breathing rhythmically and clearing and sort of a clear way, and it creates more and more stress and more and more stress, and it compounds and compounds and compounds. So that rhythmical breathing, and you know what it also does, I find, yes, it's good from a physiological aspect, but it's great from a psychological aspect too, because it just sort of calms the mind too.
Yeah. You know, I've read that there's a particular way that we can train ourselves to breathe in those instances. And it's called box breathing. We imagine a box and we breathe in for 4 seconds. We hold for 4 seconds, breathe out for 4 seconds, hold for 4 seconds. And in doing that, it physiologically will start bringing the heart rate down start calming the body. And I don't know if it's possible to do that when you're out on the waves, but I know that many of us have stressful experiences just in our daily life, maybe in front of a desk or doing something. We can learn to just incorporate box breathing to bring
so it is down. It is absolutely possible. And when I really started to explore and I didn't write about it in the particular chapter, but when I really started to explore riding inside the tube, and I developed a whole new technique for riding inside the tube, I really felt that when I was surfing at my very best, when I was in a state of flow, I could curve that wall to my will. It's sort of a psychological phenomenon. The theory was developed by a wonderful psychologist who I met and had numerous discussions with, a guy called Miha Csikszentmiha. And there was a photographer, a famous photographer at the time, who captured these movies of me riding inside the tube, and he'd be inside the tube with me, and he was shooting at 400 frames a second. So it's a high-speed camera, and it's ultra, ultra slow motion. So when I would look at the movies, he'd say, "Shaun, look at your cheeks." And what would happen is I would ride through the tube, and then my cheeks would expand. And then I blow that air out. And that was, even in that heightened state and that intense moment when you're not focusing on breathing, your body takes over and breathes in that rhythmical fashion, expelling air as fast as it can out your lungs. And obviously, one of the reasons we're doing that is that when you're riding inside the tube and you're right there on the cusp of life and death, and you could be wiped out at any moment, I'm obviously thinking in my mind, I've got to maintain as much air in my lungs as possible at all times in case I get taken out and I get taken under the water, where I really have to have a full lung full of air so that I don't drown. But interesting, I've never thought of it that way before, Christopher.
Well, that's wonderful. You exemplify a way to remain calm in stressful situations that we can learn to do. If you can learn it, we can learn it.
Certainly. Certainly. And I think, today there's so much research and so much practice of mindfulness and meditation. But with me, I think it was really simple. You just sit out there in the lineup. And I mean, I encourage anyone just in their daily lives, they want to take a hike, get connected with nature. And then when you're walking through nature, and it might be walking on the beach, or it might be hiking in the mountains, or it might just be walking your dog, that rhythmical calming breath can really help with any particular anxiety issues you might be facing. So it's super simple. It's just some calming, invigorating breaths.
It's true. So that is the lesson that we're going to take from today's episode. Is, as my grandfather said, who lived to be 98 years old, and he would stand up in front of people and he'd say, "Would you like to learn to be almost 100? And of course, they'd say, "Yes." He says, "Well, I will give you the secret." And then he would look very pensive and sagacious. And then he would look at them and say, "Just keep breathing." So that's our message for today. Keep breathing. Now, we hope our audience will join us for the next episode that we'll do with Shaun Tomson, and that will be on despair and hope, the duality of despair and hope. So, Shaun, any last words about breathing before we let you go?
I think that the deep breath and that exhale, it's so fundamental to enriching yourself. It does enrich you. And in our busy lives, we just take those regular breaths and we keep going. But sometimes it's just a time to stop and just take in those deep breaths. And I think it's like a spa for the lungs. Just do it. Suck that air in and blast it out.
Wonderful. Well, thank you for joining us today. And we're excited to go through the rest of the book bit by bit for this podcast and our YouTube channel. As we conclude today's podcast, we'd like to thank Familiars for their support in bringing this podcast to your ears and your heart. We'd be thrilled if you subscribed to the podcast and left us a review. And when you're ready for that next amazing book adventure, we'd be honored if you chose a book from Familiars, like Surfer and the Sage. One step at a time, we can make the world a happier place.